Thank you. rest of the Lord. We go to Wallace Rowland. Needs a healing. We also want to pray for Sister Parker. Needs a healing in her body.
Amen.
We also want to remember Amber and Kevin Thompson. They were in a minor accident with their car. They were kind of sore. What they did was they were kind of ran into a pothole and the airbags deployed. And, they're a little sore this morning, but they're alive.
Amen. Amen.
If you have a need, raise your hand. God knows all these needs. Let's take them to the Lord in prayer, shall we? Lord, we come to you. Thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to be in your house. Worship you in spirit and in truth. Thank you, Lord, for the privilege we have to be here. Pray, Lord, that you would touch, Lord. Heal, Lord. Touch Amber, Kevin, Howard. God, touch their bodies, Lord. We thank you for your healing power upon their lives, God. We pray, Lord, that you would heal, Lord, Sister Parker. God, Wallace, Roland, I pray you would touch, Lord, and heal their bodies, God. And all the needs are in this place tonight, today, Lord, I pray. By the raising of their hands, you know their needs, you know their situation. I pray, God, that you would intervene, God, that you would be with them. In Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Yes, you can come and receive the praise of the Lord. Give to the Lord.
Hallelujah.
This is brother and sister Ford with us this morning.
Amen.
Good to see y'all. Amen. Praise God. Roland, would you ask the Lord's blessing?
Lord, thank you for your presence in this place. Thank you, Lord, for the privilege to give this offering, God.
Thank you, Lord.
We're asking your blessings upon it. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Let's continue to worship.
Let's just magnify the Lord right now. He is worthy. Hallelujah, Jesus. I praise the Lord.
Thank you.
presence of the Lord is in this place today. Give me a little more monitor, brother. So good to see Johnny and Christy this morning. Been missing these folks. Moved to Florida, left God's country and went to Florida. But we're so glad to see them here. Praise God. Good to have Stephanie with us all the way from Houston, Texas. Going to be attending college here for a little while, and so we're so glad to have Stephanie. So you make her feel welcome today. All of our guests, we're so glad you're here. Let's give all of our guests a warm welcome. So good to have Brother Sister Clack with us. They're going to be ministering to us this morning and also at the 6 o'clock service this evening. So you don't want to miss. Be back here tonight for a great time in the Lord. We love Brother Sister Clack. Been dear friends of ours for quite a few years now. We have been wanting to get them down here to minister to us for quite some time. And with them over at Brother Watts' birthday celebration here just a few weeks ago, and Brother Clack and Sister Hodge got together and got a date, and here they are. We're so glad they're here. These are church planners, evangelists, pastors, getting ready to start another church here in the state of Georgia. And he may mention that to you in a little while. And we're so glad to have these wonderful people with us, great Christians and men and lady of God. We're so glad to have them with us. Brother Clack, come right on. We want you to take your liberty. Let's give him a warm Savannah welcome.
I can take Well, it's been a long time coming. You got a beautiful place, and I'm tell you what, my hat's off to the pastor. Great job, Brother Hodge. I've heard a lot about it. I've talked to a lot of people. I've seen some pictures, but I've never got to visit with you. Pastored a long time. I give up pastoring after I had to lost our building, and I kind of joined up with my son a few years ago, helped him out. Next thing you know, 10 years have passed, and I'm still sitting there grinning, you know. And so I tell you what, if Abraham, 99 years old, and little old Sarai, if she was 90, they could have a baby at that age. Me and my little bride, we can build a church at 69. Stand up, grab your Bible, turn to Psalms 51. I am so happy for my sister Hodge. Woo! You want anything done? Just talk to her. I'm talking about it is better than instant oatmeal. You don't even need to drop it in water, just tell her. And it'll come to pass. But we've been out for the past 2 months, every Sunday, trying to preach out every Sunday and any other time they let me, to try to raise money for this Pentecostals of Bethlehem. Yeah. The first Sunday is going to be February the 3rd. So y'all remember us on February the 3rd. Yeah. We're going to dig it out. We're just going to take off running and do the very best we can for Jesus. Yeah. And I'm going to leave this whole world from Bethlehem to head on down to the New Jerusalem. Yeah. That'll be the last thing I do. I hope you slow my Bible after the message. Yeah. You sit down and go to be with Jesus. I'm looking forward to it. Amen. I tell you what, I want you just to remember this. Be here tonight, and I'm going to have to get y'all to do that first song again tonight. We missed a key on that one. We've got to do it over again tonight. Praise God. If y'all want to have a real hoedown, be here tonight. I'm telling you, God's got something in store for us. But let's look at Psalms today, Psalms 51. Psalms 51, verse 1. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according to the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against thee only have I sinned, and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest, and be clear when thou judgest. Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part thou shalt make me to know wisdom. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness, that the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice. Hide thy face from my sins, and blot out all mine iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. Then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be converted unto thee. Deliver me from blood guiltness, O God, that God, thou God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing aloud thy righteousness. O Lord, open thy lips, and my mouth shall show forth thy praise. For thou desirest not sacrifice, else would I give it. Thou delightest not in burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, thou wilt not despise. Let us pray. Holy and righteous God,
we have finished your Lord, your wonder day, and we thank you, Lord, for this last ministry. Praise God. Bless the liberty and Jesus and the Holy Spirit.
Glory to God. Lord, run my lips that I may be worthy to speak your word unto new people. God, anoint their ears that they might hear what thus saith the word of God. And Lord, that they might apply their words to your what God sees in a sinner. What God sees in a sinner. One of the greatest scriptures and prayers of repentance you'll ever read, I just read to you in Psalms 51. David, the apple of God's eye, the giant killer, the king, he had made a serious mistake. He had sinned in the sight of God and all humanity. He had taken Bathsheba, another man's wife, got her pregnant on the day he's supposed to be out in battle, but he's wandering around on his bed and resting and having a big time, and he should have not been where he was at that time, and he had never seen what he saw, and he never committed what he committed. But yet he was at the wrong place at the wrong time, and he committed sin, and so then he had to try to cover up the sin. You can read the scriptures in 1 Samuel chapter 11. You can read it for yourselves. But David even had her husband killed. David was not only an adulterer, but he was a murderer in the eyes of God. And God said, the sword shall never leave thy house. But you know, when we think about what God sees in a sinner, there's a lot of people in America today, they really love art. A-R-T. Art. Many, however, have never developed a mind for art. Many of us never developed an eye for art. Many of us never ever see those photographs and those pictures and that mind's eye of that artist that drew it and painted it and hung it on the wall. But yet, one of the greatest things we undersee, the one writer says it like this, beauty is in the eye of the beholder. We don't all see things just alike. We don't all believe things just alike. But if you're ever going to make it to heaven, we're going to have to be in one mind and one accord and believing in Jesus. Amen? You know, if I were to go to Atlanta today, they got a big old art museum in Atlanta. Some of you may have been there. I don't know. I've never been. Don't plan to go. Hallelujah. You know, because I didn't develop that eye for art. Amen. But down there in that Atlanta Museum, there's many pictures, and most of them would be just a big old blob of paint to me. But to some, they can sit on the scene in front of that picture and look at it for days and just ooh and ah and marvel because they've developed an eye for art. Well, when we see that to God, we understand that they feel like that sometimes that is a priceless work of art. Well, I want you to know something today. God sees every single one of you as a priceless work of art. He sees you as a masterpiece. No matter what you come through, what you're going through, or what you're going to go through, God still sees you as a priceless work of art created by the Master's hand. Thank God. Yeah, amen. He don't look at all our faults and all our failures and all our problems and all our dismantles and all of our impurities and failures. But he sees each and every one of us as a living soul. Every single one of us as a living soul that maybe needs a little cleaning up. Maybe needs a little paint here and there. Maybe it needs a little glue. Some of us maybe needs to be put right back on the potter's wheel and spun one or two more times. That he might mold us like him. Right. To have that mind. He sees us as a masterpiece. God sees us like many people used to view my mother's chicken collection. Chicken collection. Right. What in the world is that, Brother Clack? Well, all my life, I would, every birthday and Christmas, my mother collected ceramic chickens She had bookcases all around the living room where she would put those little chickens. Well, you'll hear some more stories about my mother in just a few minutes when I get down there, but my mother was an alcoholic. All my life, I was born to an alcoholic. I was born to a daddy who was a womanizer, always running around, pipeliner here, there, and everywhere. But you know what would happen lots of times on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday? I wasn't a Christian. I wasn't raised as a Christian. All we knew was drinking, smoking, cussing, fighting, and scratching. Well, every Friday through Sunday, it was a war zone at the Clack house, or whoever's house we went to. But if we was in the Clack house, when they got to fighting and the fussing, then guess what? The first thing she would grab and start slinging. Them chickens. Oh yeah. Me and my little brother, we'd run out there and we'd try to catch the chickens, and she was slinging them at my daddy. We was trying to catch them, but some of them didn't make it. Well, what I would do, you know, at 2 and 3 o'clock in the morning, here we are still busting and fighting, and I got one of them big apple sacks. A lot of y'all don't know what big apple's all about. It was an old grocery store, and they used brown bags. Well, we used to keep them brown bags for trash. Well, I would go in there in that kitchen, and I'd grab me a couple of bags, and I'd go put the pieces in separate bags. I'd pick all those chickens up, and I'd put them in those bags, and the next day I'd sit down at the kitchen table, Brother Hodge, with my airplane glue and my model glue, and I'd put them chickens back together. Some of the little pieces might be missing, but they were still put together. And I want you to know, when you walk by those chickens, if you had an eye, you could see where I had glued all those chickens. You could see all those scars on those chickens. If you could just look at me in panoramic and see all the scars that I've had since I was a kid, you wouldn't believe it. But you know, you can't do that. But God came. God came. And I want you to know that He can put you back together. Some of you sitting in these seats today, I'm going to tell you I'm going to be plain, because that's the only way I know how to be.
All right.
I'm a country boy from Norcross, raised rough, but saved graciously by my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. 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 The psalmist David said in Psalms 139 and 141, I am fearfully and wonderfully made. It has been said it takes seconds to make a convert, but it takes a lifetime to make a saint. Think about that. Why? Because we are made in the master potter's image. Made in the image of God, we all are. That's why we have to love everybody. Because everybody is somebody that Jesus died for. Everybody is somebody that God had created. He put that hair on your head. He put those brown, blue, or green eyes in your head. You didn't have anything to do with it. You didn't have a choice, praise God, that how you come into this world and who your mom and daddy was. God chose them. God chose your hair. God chose your eyes. God chose your mom and daddy. You ain't got to worry about nothing but pleasing God.
Yeah.
And doing what's right.
Yeah. Amen.
John 1 and 3. All things were created by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. He did it all. You know, here's a real point. If we could see each other and ourselves as God sees us,
all right,
and live above sin,
yeah,
without sin, and He showed us it could be done.
Yeah.
Because He donned the robes of an earthly man to walk this way and live this way with flesh and blood. But yet when He looks at us, if we could just have that kind of mentality, that we are not looking at everybody to try to find fault. Because when we look at people, we don't really look for the good in them. We are just negative by nature, and we are sinners by nature, and we just look for what's wrong in them. some of you started summing me up when I walked through the door. Well, who's that guy? What's he going to do today? Where'd he come from? Now, I don't know if I like his tie yet. I don't know if I like the way he preaches yet. We always just automatically start summing up. You let some little girl walk through that door back there with black lipstick on and black fingernail polish and dyed one side purple and one side green and studs here and studs there and studs everywhere. And the first thing some of us will do is say, look, oh my God, look at that critter. There ain't no way God can save her. But you don't know. My God. I kind of know my God. Hey. Proverbs says 21:2 says, every way of a man is right in his own eyes, but the Lord ponders the heart. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 11:28, let a man examine himself. Everybody say himself. That don't mean go around, you ain't no fruit inspector. If you read and study the scripture, there ain't but one fruit inspector in the church, and that's the pastor. Amen. He's the one who got the authority. He's the man under God. Amen. You're under him. And if you get out from under him, you're in trouble. Amen. Every single person in this room needs a shepherd. You've got to have a shepherd. So yet, when he says that, and we understand that, we are to examine not everyone else, but ourselves. We are examining ourselves, but we're so busy wanting to tell everybody else what's wrong with them. We're so busy summing them up and judging them and putting them in hell that we forget about ourselves. You know, we go to that mirror sometimes and we look in that mirror, we don't see those scars. We don't see those problems and those defects and that problem we've had in our past.
Amen.
But yet we can look at somebody else and pick them out right quick.
Yeah.
Because every man's right in his own eyes. But yet we got to understand one thing. God places great value on life. He does. And we might consider them worthless. Just like that little derelict down here begging money at the red light. You know, I've read stories about some of those guys. Do you realize that some of those guys are millionaires? Some of those guys down there have money in the bank. They got a $600,000 house. And they're down there every day with their sign begging money. And they make $300 to $500 a day begging money. So what's wrong with that picture? We can't comprehend that. Because we need to get up and go to work and make our living, right? If everybody's able, Paul says you're not but an infidel. If you don't work, you don't eat.
Oh, yeah.
But God looks beyond the wreckage produced by sin and sees even the most hopeless derelict a person of great, great potential and usefulness. Look at Moses. When God finds somebody else, he said, hey, I can't do this. I can't talk. I stutter. You got to find somebody else, God. Get somebody else. Paul was a murderer and a jailbird. How many of you would have voted for him when his resume popped out? I'm going to vote for him for my pastor. That sounds like a real good deal to me. Got to put him in jail, lock him up, tell the little kids around there screaming and crying, killing their mom and his daddies, and haul them off to jail. That sounds like a real good shepherd to me.
Mom.
None of us. Rahab was a harlot, and Peter denied the Lord. And you know, when we read that Hall of Faith, I know everybody read the Hall of Faith. Scare me to death. I thought the booger got me. Everybody read the Hall of Faith.
Amen.
And you read about some of them guys in the Hall of Faith, and you kind of wonder, say, how in the world did he make it in there? How in the world did Peter make it? Here he was, he denied the Lord 3 times and even cussed a little bit. Just had a little icing on the cake. He had a little cussing in there. But here he was on the day of Pentecost. Getting the Holy Ghost. And in the next same day, he was out there preaching the Word of God. Preaching, repent. You need that time in the Lord Jesus Christ for iniquity and sin, and you shall. He said to give to the Holy Ghost. He preached. the only way to get there.
Amen.
Repent and be baptized.
That's right.
How many of you have ever, we just talked about and prayed for a young couple and just ran into a pothole and airbags jumped out on them. And those things are bad. How many of you ever seen a wrecked car? How many of you had a total loss in the car? I have too. When I finally got out from the out of the floorboard, I didn't wear seatbelts back then when I had my wreck. Cracked the windshield, had a concussion, broke the windshield with my knobby, knocked the glass out, I guess, when I hit it again, and I ended up in the floorboard upside down, trying to find the brake to stop that car from rolling. So, yeah. Well, I got out and I looked at that car, the little Honda Accord. I thought, my God in heaven, man, this thing is total. The whole front end is crashed in up to the windshield. Took it over there, they drug it over to the body shop man, and I went over there. He'd been in business for about 26 years. He got down on his hands and knees, and he started looking under there, and he started pulling this, and had a rubber hammer, and he popped that, and he checked it all out, and said, oh, yeah, man, I can fix it. I thought, he's crazy. He has lost his ever-loving mind. There's no way. But you see, you and I can't see past the broken glass. We can't see past the dents and bent metal and torn metal on that automobile. We can't see there's any way they can straighten all that out and put it back together. But that body shop man, you see, he's been down the road. He's seen a few wrecked cars. He knows what he can do with those hands. He sees that car not as a wrecked piece of junk, a wrecked mess, ready for the scrapyard. He sees that car being put back together and painted and look like a brand new one. That somebody might have some use out of it. That's the way God does sinners. That's what God sees in a sinner. He loves them. God loves sinners. He hates sin, but he loves sinners. He's a friend to the sinners. Find me one place in the Bible that he ran from somebody who was a sinner. Or shun somebody who was a sinner.
Come on.
When he found a sinner, he was all over. Ooh, come here. Let me tell you something. Hey, if you knew the water I had, you'd be wanting to drink my water.
Amen.
Oh, yeah. He said, where's your husband? She said, I don't have a husband. He said, that's right. You've had five of them. He said, the one you're living with now ain't your husband. Oh, you surely are the Messiah. Oh, yeah.
Amen.
He read her mail right there by the well.
Amen.
And then she didn't waste no time. She knew who he was. And she went back to town and started telling everybody about this man named Jesus. He told him all things ever I did.
Amen.
What are we going to do with these sinners? Wise men in Proverbs says, win his souls. How many have you won for the Jesus till lately, you know? But yet we understand that Jesus was a friend to those sinners.
All right.
Let's just look at some of the scripture about sin just for a moment. Things known about sin, we know that it is wrong. Romans 6, 1 through 2 says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we live any longer that are dead to sin? We can't live in that place no longer. You know the truth, you got to move. We know that we cannot please God without faith. Hebrews 11 and 6. For without faith it is impossible to please Him. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. No way you're going to please God without faith. You got to have faith to please Him. And he that cometh to God must believe that He is, and He's a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. We understand that we know if it's not faith, it is sin. Romans 14, 23. We know it brings death. Romans 6, 23. For the wages of sin is death.
Yeah.
The gift of God is eternal life. You go on down, you keep reading, you see Ezekiel 18:20, the soul that sinneth, it shall die.
Amen.
All right, so we know God doesn't hear sinners, and a lot of people don't really get this sometimes. Listen to this, John 9 and 31. Now we know that God heareth not. Everybody say not.
Not.
Sinners.
Sinners.
But if any man be a worshiper of God and doeth his will, him he heareth.
Amen.
We've got to repent, be a worshiper of God, and he's going to hear you when you cry. But these people getting on Facebook and Instagram and walking around the streets talking about God, and they've never had an experience with God. All they're doing is lip service about God. And God says in the scripture, they worship me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They're tied up to the things of this world. They want the things of this world more than they want to go to heaven. They want pleasure for a season. They think they're getting by.
Right. Amen.
Oh no. Apostle Paul, he told Timothy, he said, 1:15, this is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners.
Yes, he did.
Of whom I am chief.
Amen.
And I could wrestle Paul that I hadn't killed nobody, thank the Lord.
Amen.
But I'm telling you, I done some bad stuff before I got in church. Not proud of it. But I want to tell you what God will do. He'll forgive you.
Yes,
this is our lives here. Right here is our lives. Ecclesiastes 8:12 says, though a sinner do evil 100 times, and his days be prolonged, yet surely I know that it shall be well with them that fear God, which fear before him. But it shall not be well with the wicked, neither shall he prolong his days, which are as a shadow, because he feareth not before God.
All right.
Here we are. I don't know how many he won to the Lord in this place right here. Probably most of them. But listen to this. Here's where we were. 1 Corinthians 6:9. I don't normally read the New Living Translation. But for some of you young people, I wanted to read it for you today. So it's very clear. It ain't the fifth grade education you have to read the King James. This is on an even lower level for you.
Amen, amen.
Don't you know that those who do wrong will have no share in the kingdom of God? Don't fool yourselves. Those who indulge in sexual sin, who are idol worshipers, adulterers, male prostitutes, homosexuals, thieves, greedy people, drunkards, abusers, and swindlers, none of these will have a share in the kingdom of God.
All right.
There was a time.
Wake up.
There was a time when some of you were just like this.
Amen. Amen.
But now your sins have been washed away, and you have been set apart for God. You have been made right for God because of what the Lord Jesus and the Spirit of God have done for you. And such were some of you. But God, in his mercy, has washed you and made you worthy to walk on the road. About 12:30. I just want to see how many run to the door. Marshall B. Clack, born and raised at 5811 Hillside Drive, Norcross, Georgia. Some here sitting on these seats with us today, are not ready.
Heaven.
Nope. I got this morning. You may have fooled your wife. You may have fooled your husband. You young people may be fooling mom and daddy. But God knows. You might be fooling your pastor. But God knows. Right where y'all are living. Just how you're acting. Just how you're talking. It's one thing in the church when you put on your little coat and tie and your pretty dress and you come in here and grin and nobody knows but you and God. You are the person that's going to know where you're living and where you are. Born on September 25th, 1949. Yeah, I'm the elder today. 69 years old, just can't quit working for Jesus.
Amen.
Love him. Amen. He is my dearest friend. Amen. Next to my little babies, I ain't got nobody like I got Jesus.
Right.
We've had her for 46 years, and God sent her right straight from heaven to pull me out of hell and keep me from going back.
Good. Yeah.
I love her to death. Born September 25th, 1949. Crawford Long Hospital, which every university hospital has bought him out now. They're no longer Crawford Long. I was born that day at 3:58 p.m. in Atlanta, Georgia. Wasn't that night what it is today? 7 pounds and 4 ounces. My, ain't I come a long way. I told the little Chinese guy one day, or Japanese, whatever he was a foreigner, and I was sitting down in front of him, he was fixing to take my blood pressure. He poked me in the belly. I didn't weigh but 230 pounds in. He poked me in the belly. I said, hey, what are you laughing at, man? I was born 150. I'm still growing. He looked wild, pushed me away and left, never come back. Some lady showed up to take my blood pressure. I got scared of him to death. You gotta have a sense of humor, you know what? I'm taking it easy on y'all this morning because it's my first time.
Yeah.
Y'all are in trouble tonight.
Uh-oh.
You better wear them boots tonight with steel toes.
Yeah.
I'm just teasing. Lord help me. You know, when I see this, 7 pounds and 4 ounces, 19 inches long, guess when I was born? On a Sunday. On a Sunday. September 28, 1975, Sunday, born again in a spiritual realm in Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Give it all to him. You know what? I went through a lot of trouble and a lot of stuff in my life. I was a country boy. I lived through the blue law where you couldn't buy anything after 11 o'clock on Saturday night. I was growed up, as I've already told you, 11 years old. We were still in homebrew for my grandpa. Stealing white lightning from my grandpa's, stealing cigarettes from my mama, doing just what I wanted to do. Because we was just rednecks. We just had a ball. We did what we felt like was fun. We just had a great time, we thought, because that was the only thing we knew. We didn't know we were broke. We didn't know we didn't have anything. I didn't have air conditioning until I was 18 years old in my daddy's house because he was a welder pipeliner. Sometimes he'd weld, sometimes he'd be the superintendent. But he would have hated air conditioning because if he got used to it and he went out there and welded and got that hole welded in pipes and all that junk, he just couldn't handle it. He'd just get sick. So we didn't have an air conditioner for a long time. We had a window fan. But we had a time growing up. I've done a little bit of everything. But I'm telling you right now, something made a difference.
Yeah.
What would have made a difference in the world if I'd have died? It didn't make the paper that Sunday morning I was born, but it made the news in heaven on September 28, 1975.
The angels rejoiced because they saw where I came from. I have gone through people shooting at me. I have been in knife fights. I have been in car wrecks. I have been riding down the road with the axle broke on a car 120 miles an hour. I'm telling you, I've gone through some stuff. God reason for me to be here today. God saw great value in me. It did not make the newspapers, but he saw something worth it in me. You may feel worthless here today. You may really think, what in the world can God see in me? Let me read you this. All that I am or hope to be, O Son of God, I owe to thee. For thou hast brought me, and I am thine, and I, by thy mercy, thou art mine. Jesus said in Matthew 9:13, I am not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. One writer said it like this, it's never right to do wrong, and it's never wrong to do right. But as I said a while ago, when I was talking to you a while ago, telling you some things that people are sitting on these seats today. Some of you not ready to go to heaven.
Some of you have heard the message about one God, new birth, being baptized in Jesus' name, being filled with the Holy Ghost. Some of you seen your friends do it. Some of you seen your mamas and daddies do it. Some of you haven't experienced that yet probably. But I'm telling you today, don't worry about that guilt and that problem and that sin that does so easily beset us. You got to concentrate on God.
Yes.
The devil wants you to just die and go to hell with him.
Yes.
He don't want you to have peace. He don't want you to have victory. He don't want you to have joy. He don't want you to get the Holy Ghost. He don't want you talking to God. He don't want none of that.
Right.
But I'm telling you today, that devil is a liar.
Yeah.
He's the father of liars.
Oh, yes, he is.
And he will drag you further than you wanted to go, keep you longer than you wanted to stay, and it'll cost you more than you wanted to pay. Yes,
right.
It is. And I'm telling you, you want to be in crowd. Everybody don't want to be that sore thumb. All these young people want to be something in high school. They want to be something in middle school. They want to be recognized. They want to be loved.
Amen.
That's just about what it boils down to. Everybody wants to be loved.
Amen.
Everybody wants to be loved.
Right.
But I know a man, and she sang that song this morning, and I asked her to sing. I know a man who can.
Oh, okay.
He can help you forget the past.
Yeah.
Well, how do you know, Brother Clack? Some of those things, Brother Hodge, I had to deal with for 2 years before I accepted my call. I fought that for 2 years. I kept telling God, I said, Lord, the first time he called me to preach, man, I was just testifying. And I mean, that anointing come on me, and it was just unreal. And it stayed on me for a day or two. And it kept coming on me every time I stand up to testify. It come on me. And God said, you need to preach. I want you to preach. I said, but God, you know my mama. God, you know my daddy. You know what I've done. You know how I live. You know those people know me. How in the world am I going to get up in the pulpit and preach? They all know who I am. Them people I went to school with know what I did. How am I going to do it, God? I fought that for 2 years. And one day I went to the altar. I said, God, if you don't do something for me today, if you don't give me peace, if you don't help me and show, I kept looking for that evangelist to come through and tag me and say, you know what, God called you to preach and it ain't going to happen. Mm-hmm. He ain't going to call nobody to preach that way. I said, if you don't do something today, God, I'm getting up and taking my baby and my wife and I'm going home and I ain't coming back. I'm done with this. I can't take this no more. Night and day thinking about it. And on a little piece of paper I had written down when he called me to preach. I said, I tell you what, God, this thought come in my mind no sooner than I told him that. I said, you just go tell that preacher you called to preach and you want to preach. I said, okay, God, I'm going to do that. They're going to two things happen. He's either going to let me or we're going to both of us get embarrassed. And I run over there and told that preacher, I said, I'm going to tell you something. I don't know if this is going to be good or not, but God told me I was called to preach and I need to preach. He said, I've known that for a long time, Brother Clack. He said, I've just been waiting on God to tell you.
Oh, yeah.
You just had the message ready Wednesday. And then all these little elder guys, you know, they want you, these young boys, they want you to go out and prove yourself. You go get your own stump to preach on. This is my pulpit.
Yeah.
So I did. I went to nursing homes. I went to them senior citizen homes. I went everywhere in the world. They let me in the door and I preach, man. I preach a lot. My wife can't tell me, as long as you preach with your pants on fire, I'm going to like it. But if you start giving them sea stories like some of them old preachers, I'm going to get you. So I ain't telling no stories. It's going to be real. But I'm telling you today, I want you to stand. I want you to think about this just for a minute. You ain't got to worry about mom and daddy catching you. You ain't got to worry about the pastor catching up with you. Sooner or later, your sins will find you out. Sooner or later, just when you least expect it,
right,
light's going to come on. and it's going to be on you.
Yeah.
And they're going to all know what you did. But they don't have to learn that way. You can tiptoe right down here with me. I know a man.
Yes.
I know a man.
Thank you, Jesus.
Who can?
Hallelujah.
He's right here.
Oh, Jesus.
He's right here.
Thank you, Lord.
He's right here. He's right here. Just waiting patiently.
Jesus.
Waiting patiently on somebody to step out.
Pray.
You say, Brother Clack, I'm not going to tell everybody what I've done, but I want to tell Jesus.
Yeah,
and you don't have to come up here and expound everything. Say, Lord, you know.
He knows.
Thank you. Just say, Lord,
yes.
Forgive me.
Yes.
Help me, Lord,
oh,
to walk in those paths and those footprints. Help me to walk in your statutes and keep your commandments. With every head bowed and every eye closed. Father, I've come here to Savannah today to reach some heart that's broken, some heart that's confused, some heart, dear Lord, that's made mistakes, some heart, dear Lord, that has drifted away. They've lost their way, dear Jesus. And I want you today to touch that heart. Move on that individual and assure them that you're here waiting on them at this altar. If they will just take their liberty and step out today and come and pray and seek you one more time, you'll meet that need, you'll forgive them, and you'll put them back in your grace. Just like David cried out, Lord, just like David cried out, Lord, wash me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, Lord, and I shall be white as snow. I want to know if there's one in here this morning that can relate to Marshall Clack, that can see where I came from and knowing what he's done for me today, knowing he forgave me of all those things. And you know what he'll do? He'll cast all your sins in the sea of forgetfulness. He'll cast all your sins as far as the east is from the west, as far as the north is from the south. That's how far he'll cast them. And not only that, David said, and blot out all my transgressions. He's in the house. Is there one person who will be man, woman, boy, or girl enough to step out this morning and come down to this altar and talk to Jesus? Anybody? Is there one? Thank you. Thank you. It's nothing to be ashamed of. Nobody has to know. You may have not even had a sin. You just may want to come down here and meet this man named Jesus. He's a loving, kind, and gracious God. And he loves every single one of us today. Why don't you come? If you didn't come on your own, why don't you come and get behind some of these that have come and get behind them and pray with them today? God loves you. God bless you.
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
In your presence, in your presence,
oh, yes, I
find Lord, I find
it. Thank you,
Jesus.
Thank you.
Sitting at your feet,
Lord, it's time to repent.
In your presence.
He'll hear your cry.
Yeah.